thank you so much for taking out the time to attend this session on the future of FinTech at the India-UK FutureTech Festival. I would request all of you to please settle down. I hope all of you have registered, had a cup of tea or coffee. Let us begin. All of you, of course, might already be aware, but let me quickly tell you a little bit about this festival. So the India-UK FutureTech Fest is a summit of thought leaders bringing together business persons, policy makers, venture capitalists, scientists, and entrepreneurs. The fest will highlight various aspects of the India-UK tech partnership across artificial intelligence and data, India-UK tech hubs, cluster partnerships, future healthcare, future mobility, fintech, and cybersecurity. Chase India is an active participant in this fest, and Chase India is conducting this session on the future of fintech. Let me also introduce very quickly Chase India to you. Chase India is a public policy consulting firm which focuses on research-driven advisory on public policy topics in the Indian scenario. The firm has done well-received work in technology, sustainability, e-commerce, hospitality, and development sectors. The team comprises people with diverse backgrounds, collectively having experience in regulatory bodies, industry, government organizations, academia, and media. This session, today's session on the future of fintech. Fintech firms are revolutionizing the financial service landscape in India, demonstrating the significant potential for fintech services across diverse industry segments. A recently released study by EY noted that India has leapfrogged into the second place in adoption of fintech services, trailing only next to China. The transaction value of the Indian fintech sector was estimated to be approximately $33 billion in 2016 and is forecast to increase to $73 billion in 2020. Growing at a five-year CAGR of 22%. Given the exponential growth of the sector, the panel, who I will introduce now, will bring together government officials, leading fintech startups, and members of academia to share insights, experiences, and discuss the way forward for the future of fintech industry in India. So without more ado, it is my honor to introduce the panelists. I'm very proud to also announce that the audience we have today are mainly from the fintech fraternity representing government, like the Ministry of Electronics and IT, Ministry of External Affairs, industry, academia like IER, Indian Institute of Finance, startups, etc. We also have a delegation of fintech companies from UK, which is participating in the festival. The session will be moderated by Kaushal Mahan. I would like to introduce Kaushal first. Kaushal is lead technology practice of Chase India. He has over 10 years experience in spearheading government affairs and public policy campaigns for Fortune 500 companies in the technology and e-commerce sector, addressing stakeholders at the federal and state level in India. He has a deep understanding of diverse aspects, including data protection and localization, cybersecurity, consumer protection, cloud computing, electronics manufacturing, fintech, and public procurement. In the last 4 years, he has extensively consulted companies on aligning their business priorities with the government's flagship programs, such as Digital India, Smart Cities, Startup India, Make in India, and Cashless India. Kaushal, can I please request you to come up over here and take your place? So Kaushal Mahan, ladies and gentlemen, is moderating the session. I would now like to introduce our panelists, our speakers, one by one. Mr. Ram Mohan Mishra, Additional Secretary and Development Commissioner, Ministry of MSME. Mr. Mishra works on comprehensive policy making for the MSME sector in India. He has over 30 years' experience as an Indian Administrative Service officer. He's worked in the field of general administration, mines and minerals, program implementation, planning, banking, and institutional finance, revenue, environment and forests, water resources, commerce and industry, personnel management, home affairs, as well as land revenue. He's been the CEO of a government entity focused on promoting and facilitating inclusive growth, entrepreneurship development, climate change adaptation, and sustainable development. Mr. Mishra, could I please request you to come up and take your place on the dais? The next panelist, Mr. Alok Mittal, co-founder and CEO of Indify. Mr. Mittal serves as the co-founder and CEO of Indify, which is a platform for enabling debt financing for small businesses. He's also an active angel investor, the co-founder of Indian Angel Network, and on the board of the Indus Entrepreneurs Delhi. Prior to starting Indify, Mr. Mittal set up and ran Kanan Partners Venture Investment Business in India, investing in high-growth technology and internet startups. Earlier, he had founded jobsahead.com, a leading web-based recruitment business in India, which was acquired by monster.com, the global leader in online recruitment. Mr. Mittal, could I please request you to come up? We are short by a chair. I think we might be short by a chair, Manish. Can I just pick up? Sure. No. I think we should. The chairs should look. I think we can take this one. We can take this one. Our next panelist, Ms. Renuka Sane, Associate Professor, National Institute of Public Finance and Policy. Ms. Sane, her research interests are in household finance, especially on household choice in financial instruments such as credit, pensions, insurance, and equity markets, as well as consumer protection in finance. She was a peer reviewer in the Financial Sector Legislative Reforms Commission on Consumer Protection. She was also on the research team for Bankruptcy Legislative Reforms Committee on the Insolvency of Individuals and the research team for the DEA Committee on Mis-Selling. She's also a member of the Pension Advisory Committee of the Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority. May I please request you, Ms. Renuka Sane, to take your place on stage. Thank you. I would like to next introduce Suniti Nanda, Fintech Officer, Government of Maharashtra. Ms. Nanda is a Fintech Officer with the Government of Maharashtra. She is a leader and an innovation evangelist and has been in the banking industry for more than 17 years. She has worked extensively in technology delivery for banking and financial services. She's been instrumental in establishing Rise Mumbai, Barclays Global Open Innovation Program in India. In her current role, she focuses on liaising stakeholders across the vibrant fintech ecosystem and fostering accelerated co-creation and experimentation to drive innovation across transaction cycles in collaboration with the operation and technology leads in India. Ms. Suniti Nanda, could I please request you to come up? Our next panelist, Ms. Natalie Toms, Economic Counselor, British High Commission. Natalie is responsible in her role as Economic Counselor for generating collaborations between the UK and India, government and business, that will bring economic benefits to both countries. Since moving to India in 2016, she has been struck by the world-leading developments in the Indian fintech and the potential for collaboration with the UK's largely successful fintech sector, and she is excited to help take this forward, including through the fintech dialogue announced during Prime Minister Modi's visit to the UK in April. Before moving to India, Natalie worked for Her Majesty's Treasury and has extensive experience in macroeconomic policy making, mostly recently leading the team that delivered the 2016 UK budget. Natalie, could I please invite you up here? Thank you. And finally, Mr. Arnab Kumar, Manager, Frontier Technologies, Niti Aayog. Mr. Arnab Kumar leads Frontier Technologies, Artificial Intelligence, Blockchain, and FinTech initiatives for Niti Aayog. He's a key contributor to the formulation of India's National Strategy for Artificial Intelligence, and he's driving the agenda for India FinTech Mission, aimed at developing India as a global FinTech hub. He's also leading several projects in AI and blockchain with special focus on healthcare and supply chain solutions. Mr. Arnab Kumar joined Niti Aayog as the founding manager for Atal Innovation Mission and developed strategy for AIM's key initiatives, including Tinkering Labs and Early Stage Technology Fund, before transitioning to Frontier Technologies team. Mr. Kumar, could I please request you to come up? We are short another chair? Okay, he has a presentation first. Great, all right. So, Kaushal, I hand over the session to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I'm going to take the next 5 minutes to set up the stage for the discussion to follow. But before we start that, I'd like you to focus on the slide on the left and think about what exactly is FinTech. If you ask 20 people in this room what FinTech is, you'll probably get 25 definitions. So it's very, very important to have a clear understanding of what FinTech means. I'm not going to delve too much into this slide, but one thing is clear, that there are two or three large contiguous markets when it comes to FinTech. North America is one of them, but Asia has been pulling its weight in the recent years. The figure on the 2018 is probably inflated because of Ant Financial's $14 billion deal, but Asia has been the most active market if you think of FinTech in the past several years. When you think of global FinTech landscape, you'll again see probably 30 plus unicorns across the world. And what you'll see is that there are, again, three buckets which you'll see. One is North America, a large number of unicorns. Europe, with a few of them in the UK. But a large number of them in Asia also. We have two in India and several unicorns. Companies that are supposed to be unicorns in the near future. When you look at the India's FinTech landscape per se, what you'll see is that while we have seen a lot of investment in the past few years, there are clear themes. We'll see that companies which are in payments and transfer are the ones that have dominated, and companies that are in the alternative lending segment. And this is how every FinTech market across the globe has evolved. They first start with simple things as wallets, payments, and transfers, and then they eventually move the FinTech curve, which is more sophisticated products like wealth management, robo-advisory, insurtech, and online discount brokers. One thing that is very, very pertinent to India in the lending space is that we have seen a lot of activities in the SME lending segment, which is very much needed because that is one of the segment, SME and MSME, that is very much credit starved. And thanks to all these companies in trying to address that market. India FinTech adoption has been talked about. The key drivers for India FinTech ecosystem is pretty clear. We have government support through Jam Trinity. We have a large number of people on the mobile, people having internet subscriptions, and also people who may not have the best banking and technology solutions at the moment. One thing that works very well for India is the STEM population and people with a very good understanding of both technology and finance, and that is what has helped India leapfrog some of these other countries when it comes to FinTech adoption as well as evolution of the India FinTech ecosystem. I'm not going to talk about India's tech. I think everybody here knows about it, but the key message here is that probably government is the biggest disruptor when it comes to FinTech per se. Unified payments interface, I think all of you need, but have a look at the numbers here. These are phenomenal. UPI has hit $1 billion in transactions in less than 8 months. Look at any FinTech company across the globe, you will not be able to match this kind of a pace. So if a UPI was probably a private company, it would have been not just a unicorn, it would have been multiple times decacorn. So that kind of capability has been built by a consortium of banks, by consortium, and efforts being put by both the public sector and the private sector. And as a result of the focus by the government, what you'll see is that digital payments is something that has evolved a lot. A lot of these companies, the likes of Paytm, Google Pay, MobiKwik, all of them actually owe to the large infrastructure projects that the government has made when it comes to the mechanism of transfer, which is the UPI, and also the mechanism of onboarding customers, which is Aadhaar. So the two underlying infrastructure layer has been built by government support, and that has been our motive when we come when we talk about new technologies. Our idea is not to do something new. Our idea is to build infrastructure and technology on top of which private companies can then build solutions. There can be multiple use cases, but there can't be multiple players building the infrastructure project. When we see the way India should be evolving in the next few years and what are our priority areas, what you'll see is that there are certain sectors which will see a lot of interest. InsurTech would probably see a lot of new companies coming in and both government support and demand for insurance. What you'll also see is something called capital markets focused fintech companies moving towards the open banking solution. And you'll also see a lot of companies dabbling in the blockchain space, some of them in crypto, but mostly on building blockchain-based fintech solutions. When I was asked for this panel, I was asked to put forward a few areas of collaboration, which I'll leave to the panel to deliberate and discuss. One of the things that I sincerely think is important is, and a very important area of collaboration across the ecosystem is InsurTech. We have the business rationale here. We have the schemes here. There are, I mean, at least three large schemes, Pradhan Mantri Bima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, and the Ayushman Bharat, which have direct impact to all the companies which are dabbling in InsurTech, not necessarily something in terms of giving insurance, but building products and technologies around these schemes is something that might become very, very important. One thing that we are very keen to collaborate with the UK is in the space of regulatory sandboxes. Our insurance space is still regulated, and we need to create systems and innovation spaces for up and coming technology companies so that they can be enabled and they should not be mired in hundreds of regulations that exist right now. I think the government agencies have shown their willingness to set up these kind of sandbox approaches. The second important thing is open banking, which is where you focus a bank as a set of APIs rather than a set of services. And those set of APIs are then catered to by separate fintech companies so that your bank becomes a stack of several solutions and not just a simple bank. And that is where I think UK has taken the lead. They have mandated 9 banks to have the open banking platform. I think several of the Indian banks are also thinking in this space. While it's not mandatory yet, our approach has been to build that India stack, but a lot more can be done in this space as well. And as a final thought, I think a lot of work can be done in the blockchain space. UK has shown a tremendous leadership in that. They have the requisite talent. We have the requisite use cases. Several of the things that we can think of working together, one is India chain. Second is there a need for India's approach to, say, ICOs? And there are other financial services-led products like EKYC, clearing and settlement, interbank, NPA trading is something that we are working with a consortium of banks where we think if we can put all the NPAs on a blockchain-based solution and put it out there in a transparent way, there could be a mechanism for the banks to trade that. So those are the kind of solutions that we can think of which distributed ledger technology can enable. I'm going to leave this teaser with you of what is India Chain that we have been evangelizing. When you think about developing a blockchain-based solution, you have to choose a fabric, you have to choose an identity platform, and then you have to choose an incentive platform on top of which companies can build their dApps. What we are saying is that we'll take care of these three layers, and you only focus on building solutions. This is your UPI equivalent, this is your health stack equivalent, where we build that blockchain stack, and companies only focus on the real use cases, and all the infrastructural projects and requirements are being taken care of by a consortium of government-led players. So those are my thoughts, and I'll urge the panel here to probably discuss a few of these themes as we think about ways for India's fintech future and ways for India UK to collaborate. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anup. Thank you for that insightful and detailed presentations on the technology landscape also, which the government is looking at. Now I'll start the panel discussion, and just for the audience, I'll try to set up a brief context of the panel discussion. So three pointers which I want to highlight, which the PM mentioned at the Singapore FinTech Festival, and I think that's very important for the audience also to know, is he mentioned that FinTech is not a mere mechanism, but a movement. Technology intervention into finance can enhance the ease of living for citizens. And FinTech can add 6 contributions to the growth of India. That can be access, inclusion, connectivity, ease of living, opportunity, and accountability for the government also. while this has been the focus, but what we have seen through various reports, and especially I will quote the JP Morgan report, which mentioned that the fintech space has been mostly catering to the semi-urban or the urban cities and mostly focusing on the middle class and above set of income people. So the idea of the discussion today is to identify how we can address the unmet needs of this rural India or the segments which have not been addressed by the traditional banking or the financial services mechanisms, how we can contribute to the bigger role of financial inclusion, and also see what are the regulatory challenges and what kind of interventions is required to address the concerns of the fintech sector, especially around data security, accountability, or money laundering, those areas. So my first, I'll move on to my first speaker, Mr. Ram Mohan Mishra, who is Additional Secretary and Development Commissioner at Ministry of MSME. Sir, there are around 63.4 million MSMEs in the country, which cater to around, which employ around 120 million people. And 45% of export is through these MSMEs. But the biggest concern, if we still see for an MSME, is the supply-demand gap in the credit part of it. A recent Yes Bank report said that that gap is around 26.5 million Indian rupees, which can be a huge potential for the fintech sector. Could you briefly elaborate on what is the initiatives the government is taking to address this particular issues, and what support you would require from the fintech companies, especially the startups, Indian startups in this landscape, to work along with the ministry to enhance financial inclusion for MSMEs?
Thank you. So first of all, let me congratulate all of you who are present here for being the pioneers. This fintech, as we know, is the pioneering work. And I am told that most of you are in that fintech space. You're already doing something in this. As it happens to all the pioneers, there's a lot of risk when we take up new things. And that is the game. Now, the entire financial sector, out of my own experience in the banking industry, when we go for lending of any kind, and other products are also there, but fulcrum crux is the lending, the credit services. So there are two things, actually. When we lend, we look at two aspects predominantly. One is the risk from the entrepreneur whom we are lending. That is one. And second is risk to the entrepreneur from the value chains where they are positioned. Both are important for the lender. So one is where the integrity of the person, the kind of likelihood of their repaying the loan, all that comes. And this is where the huge kind of opportunities lie for us to further innovate and also do the work. And that is where the government also is taking a lot of measures. I'll just elaborate this a little bit. We all know that when we lend, we look at the credit history. And Mr. Mahan is talking about the large rural landscape where the lending possibilities are there. Now, many of these people, most of these people don't have any credit history, because they were hitherto part of the informal economy where the cash transactions were taking place. So the government has taken a lot of measures to make sure that they move on to the formal economy and go digital. But it's in transition, actually. Large number of them are now moving on to the formal economy. And this is where the measures of government like GSTN, Digital India, and so many other things which have been done, you are all aware, they are paving the way for that thing to happen, from informal to formal. Once they become formal and there is a history of a sort of credit, then it becomes far more easy for the people to assess as to what is the credit history and then lend. And therefore, it becomes important for the lenders to look into other aspects. So I would say that some sort of human fintech kind of combine has to come into place, where the integrity and the social standing and then the likely behavior of that entrepreneur can also be mapped in some way, maybe some psychological tools or some social kind of 360-degree evaluation or something. So this is one more innovation which is needed, actually. And I would like to call upon the community, which is present here, to look into this possibility. If you are able to fuse the risk which is coming from the entrepreneur's own habit and likely behavior, along with the history of the person in terms of not only credit history, but also, I would say, savings history. and then other history actually. And this is where blockchain and all these data aggregation methods are going to be very helpful as to how much he paid for the mobile phone, how much was paid for the income tax, how much paid for this. And this is where you would have seen that Honorable Prime Minister recently announced that 59 minutes loan platform, which is all about this only. Fintech plus sourcing all kinds of data in one place and then looking at future possibility. So this is one, has to be addressed. And not many schemes are there. I think it has been mentioned. And then our Niti Aayog expert also has made a mention of some of them. There are quite a lot of initiatives here and there they are in place. The second thing is, when I am the entrepreneur and I wish to repay, as on yesterday, I wish to repay. I don't have any intention to, any malafide intention. I mean, my integrity is beyond doubt. But the business does not do well. And this is where the SWOT of the business itself, the business idea and the positioning is important. And this is where you would have seen this entire MSME outreach program is geared up for creating that ecosystem for business. So I would urge that when you talk about fintech, so finance is one important critical input of the ecosystem. But there are many more. Many more means skilling of the person, entrepreneurship training, clustering, market access, access to technology, ease of doing business. There are various aspects of the business ecosystem which impinge upon the success or failure of the business. So when we talk about fintech, I think we need to create a coalition of forces where the other players in the system also come on board somehow. And this is where we would be looking forward. We are more than willing. We are now nurturing a very, very ambitious program where all this we are trying to aggregate, not only from the supply side, from the government side, but all of you. And together, we have a platform called Udyam Sati. And on this platform, we are inviting all the people who have a stake in the system, either from the non-profit side or from the profit side, from the commercial side, all of us together. So until and unless we are able to put in place everything which is required for the success of the business and enterprise, where we are applying this credit and other financial services products, I think there are problems. So SWOT of the individual entrepreneur, SWOT of the ecosystem, of the value chain, all this needs to be put in place, analyzed, and gaps need to be filled. So this is where I think the technology makes it possible. And this is a future tech, not only fintech, future tech. And our Prime Minister has announced also 6,000 crores of investment in technology itself, all aspects of technology. And where we are going to follow the hub and spoke model, where technology access is important. Because if in the business we are applying obsolete technology, money may be there, but money is unsafe. So I think very briefly, this is what I would like to say. And I would look forward, actually. So any of you who are willing to kind of take it forward from where I've just spoken, you are more than welcome. And as I said, this Udyam Sati and one more Udyam Sakhi, that is for women entrepreneurship. And on 14th, we are having a national conclave on social enterprise. So who is a social enterprise? Everybody who is looking at larger issues of society, of economy, beyond one's own profit is more than welcome. And I think for now, briefly, that is what I will leave.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the insights. And I think the industry would be very keen to have this discussion apart from this session with you. Now I'll move on to Renuka. And Renuka, we clearly see there's a demand of fintech solutions like credit, insurance, mutual funds, especially for the rural market. You being at NFPFP, which is a research institution, premier research institution in public finance and policy, what according to you are the constraints that come in the way of the growth of the fintech sector, especially with respect to financial inclusion or access? And what kind of support does the government need to provide, especially the small fintech, because for them to reach the last mile would be a costly affair? What kind of government support does it require for them to reach the last mile of the unserved markets?
Thank you, Kaushal. So, you know, as an academic, I don't have any solutions, but I'll offer some analysis of what we think is the problem, right? So we say that financial exclusion is a problem. And one must ask, why have we reached a place where financial exclusion is a problem? And what is it about the environment that does not lead to different business models that can reach and service people across the country who have different needs? So the question is, what is inhibiting the growth of business models or products and services that are new, unique, innovative, disruptive? And to my mind, I think we need to go back to the root cause and say, what's the stumbling block? And I would say that perhaps we need to think about the regulatory environment that we offer the ecosystem that might be a stumbling block for new business models to come in. So let me elaborate on that a bit. So if you start thinking about first principles of regulation, why do we have a regulator? We have a regulator because we want to solve certain problems. We want to solve the problem of microprudential, you know, we do microprudential regulation, we want to solve the problem of consumer protection, we want to solve the problem of systemic risk. And, you know, because we want to solve these problems, we create certain regulations as to who can come in, what can they sell, where can they sell, what capital they might have, what are they allowed to do, what are they not allowed to do. If they do something that violates certain norms, what are the penalties on them? Now, the challenge really is, how do you create an environment whereby you sort of balance the need of innovation along with the need for, say, a consumer protection or systemic risk? And my view is that I think we in India become a little more conservative, and we constrain various business models because we worry about the implications on consumer protection or systemic risk. And because of that, you know, innovation gets inhibited, and because of that, business models that could service different geographies, different societies within India find it difficult to come up. And if you want to actually have a larger impact of fintech, and if we want different kinds of businesses to bloom, then I think we must think about how is it that we are going to create a regulatory environment that makes this possible. Let me give one or two examples, right? So for example, entry barriers in banking. So for the longest time, we've not given out banking licenses for the size of the country that India is. And one must ask, why is that so? Or the structure of banking itself. Why is it that we don't allow for differentiated banks, differentiated products? Or when it comes to P2P lending, my sense is that we put in a lot of constraints on the way P2Ps could function. We made all of them NBFCs. And so that straight jackets them into one way of operating. And what that does is that it inhibits what P2P might do and how it might enhance people getting credit. Of course, I'm not saying that it should be free for all, but the challenge really is that how do you balance consumer protection as well as innovation? And I think that that's what we need to focus on.
Thank you. Thank you, Danika. I think that opens a complete new perspective of how regulations has been seen in the BFSI sector in India as of now. Now I'll move on to Suniti. And just to give it, Suniti is the FinTech officer with the Government of Maharashtra. And first of all, congratulations on the new accelerator program. She and her team has been working hard on making Mumbai the FinTech hub for India. And in fact, Maharashtra is the only state which has a FinTech policy as of now. I'll ask two very practical questions with you. In your journey till now, what are the key challenges that any of these startups come to you, and how, as a government of Maharashtra, you're addressing it? And the second one is, in terms of the skill-based requirement for this sector, what is your government's plan, government of Maharashtra's plan, to address those requirements?
Thanks, Kaushal. So just a quick correction. So we just don't want to make Mumbai the fintech hub for India. We actually want to make Mumbai the fintech hub for the globe. So we are dreaming big, or I would say like we have, I would say large aspirations, and I'm sure like this is something we can make it happen. And Mumbai has been the financial capital. I was speaking to a group of people today, and we can definitely make it happen. So coming back to your question, what are the problems that fintechs have? Problems are plenty, frankly speaking. And I would summarize, like in last 4 or 5 months, we are actually trying to spend a lot of time to hear them out. Because many times we sit in that room and think that, okay, let's create a policy, let's announce some money for them, and then things are better off. Even though I'm in the comment side, I'll probably like, pardon me if I'm making any mockery of things, but then there is a like trust level that has to be built, and this is something that is one of my key focus, that what is that we can do to like, you know, make sure that they come and tell us that this is the problem. That's like one of the very first thing that they don't know whether, like, even if they talk about something, whether that will be done or not. It's more like, okay, nothing happens. Or like, let's say you speak to somebody and then like you listen and then like it's just like it's there in that tour. So companies are looking for the basic needs are out there, okay? Whether it is the space or it is access to capital, the market access, the ecosystem, everything, the teams there on the ground, they struggle. We hear about the rosy stories, the fundraise that had happened. People who have reached that, like Series A, Series B, are all the good stories. But then there is a large set of people who don't see that. There's a, like, our mortality rate is very, very bad, and this is something we have to really work at. What can we do to make sure our startups don't die? And when I'm saying our startups don't die, I'm particularly talking about the ones which has the real potential. There are people which we have seen that they have good potential, but they just don't know how to go to the next stage. There's like a company, I'll take the name, called Finlog. They are doing something in the saving side. Probably like it's been a year that I am seeing them. And I could see that they have not figured out what is the right revenue model. It is not something which will probably fetch them a quick money, because they are not targeting the segment which has money. They are targeting the lower segment, right? So the point that I'm trying to mention here is there are good solutions that are out there. There is a segment who is doing it. So as government, the kind of support that we need to really give is find those good solutions and ensure that they live. Ensure that they get the right kind of support to really implement that solution. That is like one of the key asks that we hear from the fintech ecosystem, that help us in solving it. The second part that, I mean, this is something that I would mention as a like observation. There are like many companies we also see that which is not of the right quality. When I'm saying not of the right quality, probably they are not solving the right problem. So they are the enthusiastic bunch. They have created something, but either they are like a me too kind of a problem, or it's already crowded and the solution that they're doing, they might have to like change their course of the segmentation itself, or rather like, you know, pick up a good issue. So the point that I'm putting here is bringing out those use cases, the right kind of use cases, getting access to that. So this is something, even like there are like these startups who are out there, they can solve it, but they don't know whether like this is a real problem for bank or this is a real problem for government. How can we get access to it? So this is something I have been speaking to even multiple banks in many forums, that what is that we can do to standardize these, like, you know, use cases and give it to the right people who can make something happen. And this is, again, like you go and Google use case, you will get like a list of use cases. There are many people who come to me and say that, okay, we have 500 use cases, why don't you like, you know, take it? It's not like that. When I'm saying use case, you really need to work on it, bring that up, sponsor that, and back it in such a way that when you're saying that this is my problem statement, let's say X bank says that this is my problem statement, and as a startup, why, if I'm developing a solution, ultimately the bank should really work with that startup to make it happen, go that last mile. So that's that kind of use case I'm talking about. As government, if I say that this is my area, this is where I want to, you know, take that insurance product or my banking product, then I really have to sit down with those set of people to really solve and create that solution. Then those solution will have the right value. It's not something that like you come and create something, probably it is not solving the right problem. So access to that use case is another key area. Coming to the next question that you mentioned, like, you know, the skill requirement, it could be like little off track, but then it's more of while we're speaking to a lot of people and while the fintech ecosystem is like is moving up, and it is not just like just for India, across the globe is what we have heard, that there is a like skill gap that is coming when it comes to fintech. People who are out there, all these like, you know, Java and .NET trained people are not probably the best people who can cope up with the need. So what do we do? Like, we have to like, you know, invest it in such a way that we create the future now. So like, you know, invest even like people who are studying engineering, they need to probably be more trained so that the moment they are in the market, they are able to like either like, you know, create their own or join a startup or like join the bank with the right kind of skills. So this is an area where we are actually trying to liaise with lot of academic institutes and lot of like, you know, enablers who are there in the market, who are gradually looking at this space as, you know, those fintech masterclasses and those like, you know, online training and stuff like that. But these things are happening in pockets. If I just like, you know, pick up, let's say Mumbai as an example, probably in a year, it could be like, you know, tens and hundreds of people who are getting trained or like max a few thousand people who are getting trained. But the requirement for the sector is huge. And this is why I'm saying that like the academic institutes are playing a very, very crucial role. And I'm glad that the response that we are getting from the academic institute is really great. Starting from your tier one to like even tier three institute, everyone wants to do something in this space so that they can enable the mass to be like, you know, be more contribution that they can actually do for this sector. So that's something in future also we'll be like putting in more focus on that.
Thank you, Suniti. In fact, the real-life experiences and case study that you shared would be helpful for some of the startups in the fintech space. I'll move on to my next speaker, Alok. Alok, you have experienced this because you have lots of experience in the startup ecosystem. And regulations and innovations don't go hand in hand. But if regulations are made in such a pattern that they can enable the ecosystem, it benefits both all the players in the ecosystems. You have been active at DLAI, Digital Lending Association of India, India Fintech Forum, which are the premier associations and voice for the industry. What are the key regulatory interventions or the challenges that you see as a sector you face as of now, which is important for the operations and the expansion plans also? And how is an industry you're approaching it?
Thanks. You know, I'm going to kind of focus my comments around digital lending as a subsector within fintech. You know, that's the one that I'm most familiar with. I think the overall theme of like regulatory challenges is very much around what Renuka mentioned earlier, which is that fundamentally regulations are designed for stability and not for innovation, right? And that is really the boundary we need to cross if we see fintech as an enabling tool for inclusion, job creation in the country. I think there are two specific areas where this is affecting the industry at this point in time, right? And at least in the small business financing space, the whole theme is that of flow-based lending. And there are a couple of things that are not flowing, right? One, capital is not flowing, right? And again, the root cause of that is because that whole system is designed for stability, not for innovation. Today, the wholesale cost of borrowing for a fintech company can be anywhere in the 14 to 15% range, right? Our expectation as a country and as entrepreneurs is that we should be able to support small businesses at 12%, right? This is just lopsided. This is in spite of the fact that, you know, fundamentally cost of capital in this country is, you know, by and large indexed to the rate of inflation. You know, it is 6%, it's 7%. Whereas by the time that wholesale lending gets to a fintech company, we are talking 14, 15%, which means lending rates gets into 20s, right? It just inhibits the take of the, and so pricing is one issue. Just the sheer flow of capital is another issue. In much of the banking system, there are explicit norms for lending which don't allow people to lend, banks and financial institutions to lend to younger companies, right? So it's not just the cost, but also just the sheer availability of capital which becomes the constraint. All this while the amounts of capital that we are talking about are well below what you could call any degree of systemic risk out there, right? So I think there is a need to think about what kind of norms apply for flow of capital at what levels of capital, right? And that linkage is not drawn up right now. There are three-year profitability norms around flow of capital. You know, there is the ratings norm around flow of capital. Rating companies themselves will look at, you know, the vintage as a key parameter. So there is impedance to the flow of capital, you know, flowing out of regulations. I think the second piece is really the nature of regulation in terms of process prescriptions, right? Much of the regulation is drawn upon exactly telling how to do a particular thing, right? We face that issue with KYC norms, the speaker before me mentioned the India stack. As of now, that whole India stack is suspended for private use. And so really, I think what the regulators need to be able to do is to come out and say, these are the three questions we want you to be able to answer, and then allow innovation in how people are answering their questions. Today, the nature of regulations very often tends to be prescriptive, where they tell you exactly how to answer it, and then that takes away the scope for innovation in that process, right? Now, this is not just relevant to what's happened on the Aadhaar verdict, but it's also relevant to other areas, like we mentioned open banking earlier. The flavor of open banking that we are currently bringing into India is nowhere close to open banking, right? So it's, I shirk at the same term being used for the two, because it does convey something very different from where we are headed, which is to create an offline intermediary to broker this flow of data, right? It's not open banking at all. And we can see this in multiple spaces. There is a TREDS framework that came up for invoice discounting to bill discounting for small businesses. Again, very, very prescriptive in how exactly that process must flow, right? Right down to a decision tree. And that takes away the scope of innovation that fintechs are bringing to the table. So I think those are the two big areas in my mind, around capital flows and around how process innovation is allowed by being less prescriptive about exactly how the system should work. I think if I come back to the notion of where else collaboration can happen, that's obviously a much wider canvas, right? I think government has certain strengths in tapping the demand ecosystems, right? There are various schemes for MSMEs where market linkages are being facilitated. It will be helpful if all of those market linkages are then layered with financial linkages that fintechs and incumbents can bring to the table, right? There is a lot of data that is stored inside government system, whether it's taxation, now GST, MCA data. All of that should be made available basis consent now that we have the data architecture and the, at least the wireframe of what the data regulation is going to look like. I think that should pave the way for really making those accessible through consumer consent and making sure that there is data availability to be able to underwrite better and so on. I think one of the things that government should not be doing is picking which startups are running behind the right use cases and which are not. Right, I think that is not the role of the government. That is the role of the ecosystem that you build. Enabling that ecosystem certainly is the role of the government, right? So letting a 500 seed funds flourish in India is certainly something that requires policy intervention. But who's running after the right use case, right? Who's building it the right way? That is something that markets should resolve. So I think that is an area where I would suggest government should stay out of, because that tends to bring in, again, a unitary view of, this is the right solution and this is not, before the market has had an opportunity to decide.
Thanks, Alok. From the point-to-point submissions, and in fact, MSMEs and rural markets could be the focus for the fintech solutions in the future. Moving on to the last speaker, Natalie. There has been lots of focus by the UK government, especially for the fintech landscape in India. And a series of delegations for UK companies have been visiting India in the last couple of months. Could you elaborate more on what is the focus areas of this partnership? And the trick question over here, the second question would be, which country do you consider as a competition to UK, especially with respect to fintech partnerships?
Thank you very much, Kosho. I think I'll take the first part of your question first. And actually, listening to the other speakers today has already underlined to me the really exciting potential for more collaboration between the UK and India in the fintech space. Both of our countries are pioneers in fintech, but we're leading in very in different areas. India has obviously the most sophisticated public payments technology in the world, whereas in the UK we're moving into areas like InsurTech, P2P, peer-to-peer lending, open banking and others. So there's lots of potential for us to learn from each other and collaborate. But beyond that, the thing that's really struck me from the discussion today is that actually as policymakers in both countries, we're all facing similar issues. The challenge of how you regulate in a sector where innovation is outpacing regulation, how you encourage innovation while protecting consumers. These are issues which countries all over the world are grappling with, and which where it's fantastic for us to be able to have conversations. In the UK, as the kind of global center of financial services for a long period of time, this is something which as the fintech industry began to kind of emerge around 10 years ago, this is something that our regulators were quite quick to pick up on. And I think in 2015, our Financial Conduct Authority put in place a big innovation of their own, which is the world's first regulatory sandbox. The sandbox essentially provides a safe space for new fintech startups to innovate, and have new ideas and test those out without you know, worrying about the regulator. While also providing a safe space for the regulator to see what developments are taking place and work out how to frame their regulations in light of that. It's also an innovation which has allowed fintechs to access finance because they've been able to provide show backers the security of the sandbox. And I think it's been a great success, and one which has now been copied all around the world, including by many of our competitors in India and in other countries. But our regulators are definitely not kind of resting on their laurels. Mr. Kumarali mentioned the area of open banking. This year, we've told our 9 biggest banks that they have to practice open banking. And this opens up a huge, huge potential for fintech, because it means that fintech firms, small startup fintech firms, can get access to the huge amount of consumer data held by the large banks. This means that they'll then be able to develop products which can be tailored, especially in areas like small business loans, to consumers and businesses. That's really exciting, and I think it's in large part because our regulators have taken such a kind of forward-leaning, pioneering approach of their own that the UK fintech sector has been so successful. I think at £6.6 billion a year in the sector, 60,000 people employed in the UK in the sector, I think the most in the world. I think 60% of the fintech startups in Europe, as well as some of the unicorns mentioned by Mr. Kumar. So I think that's regulation itself is an area in which we're obviously really happy and keen to share experience as the Indian government also looks at and grapples, I say, with exactly the same questions. But I should mention, of course, that's government-to-government collaboration. The most important type of collaboration clearly is still between the people in this room, business to business. And I know that in the room today we have a number of UK fintechs who are already providing wonderful services to people in the UK and around the world, whether it's from investing in gold, money transfer, small business loans, financial advice. They're all here. And here and to find out about the Indian ecosystem and take ideas home and also and trade and investment. I think we also have here today Pontac, who a UK venture capital firm that recently put I think $2 million into the Indian Centre of Excellence in Chennai, incubating Indian fintechs. And I think it's for all these reasons that in April, when Prime Minister Modi visited the UK, we announced a UK-India fintech dialogue, which is going to contain all three aspects. So government-to-government discussions, regulator-to-regular, but also the important business-to-business ones that are taking place today. Thanks.
Thank you. I think you didn't answer my trick question. We'll take it offline, I know. First of all, I know there's no question answer session because we ran over time, and I'm getting constant reminders from the organizers that we have already passed time. But we'll try to take these questions offline with all the panelists. Just to sum it up, I'll not sum the what has been discussed in the discussion, but we have seen that the discussion is happening in the fintech space, but in different pockets. Policymakers, startup ecosystem, academia, and all this. So we, as Chase, what we are planning to do is put up a framework on future of fintech. for India, and especially focusing around MSMEs and the rural India. And we'll try to ask inputs from each and every of you and your contribution to this particular framework so that we can build up those particular ecosystem which you want for the future of fintech in the country. So we'll be personally reaching out to each one of you. I would like to thank all the panel for their views and... we are just... Yes, please go ahead. Just identify yourself and put it to the...
Am I
you're audible.
Part of the banking ecosystem for more than a decade, and I've been on the lending side. One did mention that there is a lack of credit and capital flows to fintech companies.
Right, and typically you mentioned 18-20% as a cost of borrowing, which traditionally is more than 20% in some of the cases. So the question is to Mr. Mishra or Niti Aayog or Rishai Commission. In case we are already applied for a venture debt on funding fintech specifically, at a pricing which will be typically at 13-14%, right? And we have private sponsors backing us. Would government be keen in terms of being a participant looking at those kind of funds who are only be concentrating on fintech's credit appetite in terms of funding them? Thanks.
The government had set a very high-powered committee. You must have heard about it, headed by our Secretary DA. And that report is just about to come. So based on that report, many possibilities will emerge. So we wait for that. And then second is, the last thing I would like to say is that there's a lot of scope for partnerships, because wherever market failure is there, Alok was talking about markets to play. That is fine. That's how we have to work. But there are a lot of areas where the market failure is there. And this is where some bit of incentive has to come for people to take that risk and go there. And this is where partnership with the public, public-private partnership needs to be visualized. And what you're saying is part of this, I would say. Not only this, other support mechanisms to reduce the risk to the people who go to the areas where the market failure exists. And this is what we need to do, and we need to do a lot of research, deep diving into all these issues, and work together, and I am happy that he has already offered his services. So a lot of work is needed, and then we will be, more than happy to associate ourselves with this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for the answer, and I'll be in touch with you and take your input specifically for this part. Lastly, I would just like to thank all the panelists. I know we had a time crunch, but everyone was put to the point and gave their best recommendations how we can look at future of fintech. I would like also to thank the British High Commission team specifically for all their support and this opportunity to chase to host this session. And especially my team members, Robin, Nishtha, Anil and Manish, who has worked and helped me in putting up this content to particular this event. A thanks to everyone of you who has spent some time to be part of this discussion. Thank you, everyone.